Okay, 1 minute to live. Okay, you're gathering.
Yes.
We're just on that graphic up there. I'm going to stay on it for a minute. Let me know when that comes off, will you? You could tell me how many viewers you have, and then I'll decide when to switch over to the video.
Let me explain. You are a criminal. I've seen that face and place. You're a famous gangster. I've seen your pictures in the papers or the post office with a lot of numbers on your chest. Officer! Officer!
Yes, ma'am. Anything wrong?
This man, he...
Oh, it's Don Lockwood.
Don Lockwood?
Out first row.
Actually, yes.
You sure are a lucky lady. Good night, Mr. Lockwood.
Good night, and mum's the word. Well, thanks for saving my life. I'd very much like to know whose hospitality I'm enjoying.
Selden, Kathy Selden.
Enchanted, Miss Selden. I'm sorry.
Here you go, RF.
Ladies and gentlemen, we're here tonight to honor the brightest stars and monuments of picture stable, Don Lockwood and Neil Hahn. A very special cake, full of surprises.
Thank you.
lady is standing on her balcony in a rose trellis bower, flooded with moonlight.
Musical picture. Wait, why don't you turn The Dueling Cavalier into a musical?
That's impossible.
Why? You've got 6 weeks before it's released.
Well, sure. Add some songs and dances, trim the bad scenes, and add a couple of new ones.
And you've got it.
Yeah, but do you think I can do it?
Of course you can do it.
The picture is saved. Hot dog.
Hallelujah.
Listen, if we can pull this off, this thing will go down in history for me. March 23rd.
No. Your historic day is not the 23rd. It's the 24th.
What do you mean the 24th?
It's 1:30 already. It's morning!
And what a lovely morning!
Sounded like live music to me.
It did sound like it was live music. Hello, everybody. Happy Saturday night. It's so good to be here with you. There I am. Which camera am I on?
You're on always
this
on
one.
The same
hey.
Camera as usual.
How are you, everybody? We are watching scenes from Ed Singing in the Rain, which was a school production. The star of it is Natalie Popp. Natalie is 12 years old. I have never seen a production of Singing in the Rain on the stage, let alone one from a school. So this was really fun for us to see and watch. It's the first time Todd and I have had a chance to see it. Ryan is the person that found Natalie and brought her to us because he was telling me all about her. And it's very exciting because, you know, I remember me when I wanted to be an actress, I kind of figured that out by about 5 years old. And I was doing musicals in high school. So when I look at this, it just takes me back to that wonderful, wide-eyed, you know, dreams that we have. And that's what this show is really going to be about because we have Natalie here tonight, and I'm going to bring her in a minute. But this show is about dreams, because Natalie has a dream. She's already starting on her dream. At 12 years old, you know, it's so important to know what you have, what you want, because if you are, you know, interested in the performing arts like this. But it takes so much gumption to do it. It takes a lot of rehearsal. It also takes a lot of, I don't know, honey, what would you
chutzpah.
Say? Chutzpah. There's a good word for it. But what a beautiful job she did. So I want to go ahead and bring Natalie Pop to the screen. Ryan, go ahead and highlight Natalie and welcome her to the Cat and Todd Live Show. There we go. All right, so what, until we bring, there you go. Hey, Natalie, how are you tonight?
Good, how are you?
I'm really good. So you're currently 12 years old right now, right?
I am 13 right now.
And you're going to be 14 tomorrow then?
Yes.
Okay,
yes.
So when you were 12 or 13 for the clips we just saw. How old were you when you...
I was 13.
Okay, so tomorrow is your hippo birthday, 14th birthday, right?
Yes.
Aw. So Natalie...
That's a younger start than anybody I know.
That's right. Even Debbie was 18, wasn't she? When
way she... older.
Now Natalie knows a lot about your mom. And you know,
Natalie knows a lot about my mom. That's good.
Yeah, no, she does. And
if you're gonna play her in a show, it's good to know something about who you're playing.
Right, but you know what's really great is that I do want to ask you about some stuff, because the first part we saw was clips from Singing in the Rain Junior, right? Right.
Yes.
And that was last November in Wisconsin, correct?
Yes.
Where are you? You're located in Pennsylvania now.
I'm in Madison, Wisconsin right now.
Oh my gosh, how did Ryan find you? I thought that he found you somewhere in Pennsylvania. Hold on, let me ask the man himself. Ryan, how did you find Natalie?
I don't need to bring myself on for this, but I actually met her mom through the Debbie Reynolds Studio Store page.
Oh.
And we got to talking and it went from there.
Oh. Gosh, this is even more remarkable. Well, this is just great. And Natalie, I was loving all your clips. Let me ask you something before we get into...
Have you met Natalie before? Have you ever introduced...
No.
Natalie, I'm Todd. Good, nice to meet you. This is Kat, in case you haven't met her. No one introduced anybody yet.
Okay, so...
So that's... Introduce yourself.
Okay, so I'm Kat Fisher. This is Todd Fisher.
I'm Todd. And I am Kathy Selden's son. And this is Kathy Selden's daughter-in-law.
Yes, that's exactly right. Let me ask you this, Natalie. Do you get nervous before, you know, were you nervous before you went on the first night for Singing in the Rain?
Yeah, so I was pretty nervous, but once I got on stage, I was so comfortable because I knew all of this by heart, and I was just so excited to be able to perform it.
That is really so true. When you...
What a novel concept to
be
prepared.
Exactly. And you know what's so true about that? When you know your lines, when you know your music, and I'm going to use this as a metaphor because it isn't just in acting.
I'll make it even easier. When you know the subject.
When you know the subject.
Whatever it is.
Yeah.
So if you're doing a speaking engagement and they ask you to talk about nuclear physics, you could get kind of nervous if you don't know anything about nuclear physics. On the other hand, if they ask you, do you know the lyrics to My Lucky Star? Well, there you have it. You'd feel pretty comfy.
Yeah.
Yes.
And it's interesting, too, because I remember when I used to do musicals in high school, and even I had really bad stage fright at one point. Until I started doing live theater again on Broadway, I wasn't used to it. I was a television actress. We didn't have a live audience. But I, like yourself, you know, before you go out, you get the butterflies, right, Natalie? And then after
yes.
you get the butterflies yep. and you get, and the curtain opens and there you are, and the first line that comes out or the first musical note you sing, it takes just 10, 15 seconds and you settle in because, like you said, you were prepared.
And part of being prepared is having the right makeup on, and she has very nice makeup job. Would you look at the makeup she's wearing?
I am looking at it.
Did you see that?
Yes, I am.
I mean, it's well done, right?
Very.
Right here, right here, Kat.
Yes,
look,
I'm
isn't
looking.
That, are you wearing,
that,
are you wearing Kat Cosmetics?
No.
You should be.
But I'm going to send her some.
That's what I mean.
Exactly.
Okay, so you got a new sponsor just now.
Yes, I, yes,
Kat,
you do.
Kat Cosmetics is now going to be sponsoring your makeup.
So, Natalie, just for a moment, I'm going to read you something that one of the people in the room, because I have currently a lot of people here tonight, and Seth Robichaux, who is also a performer and a singer, and he said, "Happy birthday, Natalie. I love that you are striving for your dreams at such a young age." So, Natalie, is that your dream, to be an actress?
I don't know. I definitely want to do, I've been thinking about doing something either dance, singing, or acting related, because I just love being on stage performing for people.
Yeah. So,
well, wouldn't the word performer then work for you pretty well? You want to be a performer?
Yes.
You know that my mother actually liked live performing more than the movies, because the connection with the audience was something that she really enjoyed more so than
when you.
I don't know if you've done anything on camera, but you know, there's no one there. You know, you're performing to potentially a camera. You know, and there's certainly no audience to respond to. So some people prefer live. My mom always loved live. Not that she didn't like doing the movies, but if you said, "Hey, pick, quick, music stop, pick."
She would have picked live.
Live, anytime.
Yeah. My question to you is then, you're a dancer and a singer. And
yes.
So would you be happy to teach that? What, when you said, you know, I want it to be something in that field, what do you mean by that?
I don't know. I think teaching would be a lot of fun because I could inspire more people to do what I love. But you can also do that for performing, because someone could see you perform and then be like, I want to do that. So it could go either way.
Yeah,
well,
that's true.
Actually, my mother for decades said, that's why she bought DR Studios. She said, I want to teach. It's just she never had the time because she was always performing. And then by the time she had the time, she was 80-something years old. And I think that's what she would have liked to have done, is, you know, just sat in a chair and taught people at the end, you know?
Right. So Ryan's going to show a montage.
I have some pictures here.
While we talk.
Well, do you want to do that? I'll bring that up on camera then.
Yeah, we'll bring that up on camera.
Okay, go back to the beginning because I didn't see the first slide yet.
There you go.
There you go.
And so, Natalie, we're going to keep talking while we show these slides, because these are all slides of your career. And you know, it's so interesting, Natalie, because at 12 years old, we really don't know what we want. There's very few people that know what they want at 12, 13, 14, even 15. It's very hard to even figure that out when you're in high school and you're about to graduate, and you've got to make some decisions about what you're going to do. So it's nice that you have a handle on that, and I think you would be an excellent teacher, which is, for me, teachers are inspirers. And you know, you it's great to teach, because you really see when people walk into your class, you're like, you're going to do great. And then you see some that probably won't go on just because they're not showing the amazing amount of discipline it takes. And you have to give up a lot for a career in show business. So I'm happy that you're thinking about teaching, because I think that the world needs more teachers, and I think the world needs teachers who can inspire. And you seem to love what you're doing, do you?
Yes, I do a lot.
Oh, that is so great. So how did you get that part of Kathy Seldon in Singing in the Rain?
Yeah, so I auditioned at my local theater called Verona Area Community Theater, and I've been doing plays there since I was around 4 years old.
Oh my gosh.
Yeah. So when I saw they were doing Singing in the Rain, I was so excited. So the first thing you did is you go in there and you sing a song, and I sang Shaking the Blues Away by Doris Day. So the next thing is, some people got callbacks. So I got a callback for Lena Lamont and then Kathy Seldon. I knew I had always wanted Kathy Seldon, but I would be super happy with either part. And then I got a second callback with about like two people for Lena Lamont and then two people for Kathy Seldon. So we did that. And the person who played Don Lockwood was also there to read lines with us. And then later that night, the cast list came out. It was very fast compared to the other plays. And then I saw that I got Kathy Seldon, and I was so excited.
Could I hear your Lena Lamont?
That's what I was going to just ask too. Can you do a Lena Lamont line for us just in that voice so we can hear it?
I'll give you the line if you
want.
The line goes like, and I can't stand him.
And I can't stand it.
Stand him. Remember, then she says, round tones, round tones. the voice teacher.
Yeah, Lena then says, and I can't stand it again. She was so great.
Can't.
So, how many times did you have to, not have to, how many times did you watch the original before you did this play? The original movie?
So I was first introduced to Singing in the Rain when I was probably in first or second grade by my grandparents. And I've watched it a couple times since then, but I just love listening to the music whenever I want to listen to it. It's just so good music, and I just love the story.
Look at that poster over your shoulder. Is that a Spanish half sheet of Singing in the Rain over your shoulder?
Yes, it is.
See?
Very good.
Now, is that an original or is that a copy of?
It's an original.
I thought so, because those are actually somewhat affordable. Some of the foreign languages. That poster right there in English is thousands of dollars.
Is it?
I should know.
Right. Well, you know, I one of my favorite. The funny thing is, it was just looking at your pictures that Ryan put up while we were talking, and I noticed a picture that of the three of you. And I was thinking, gosh, I wish I could see them do Good Morning, because that's my favorite number.
Sure.
And, well, I love Lucky Star, but Good Morning is many people's favorite number. I try to sing it every day when I wake up. That's just how I get myself, you know.
We have those costumes, by the way. We have the Good Morning costume and Donald and Jeans from Good Morning.
Yeah,
we also
have
the birthday cake outfit, that the little pink outfit, All I Do Is Dream of You, and the birthday cake pop out. We also have You Were Meant for Me, the chiffon outfit where she's on the ladder.
Yeah, we saw that just now.
Yep.
Well, I was wishing I could see you all sing Good Morning, and guess what? We're going to get to, because I just looked down at my notes, and we have that in a clip, which we're going to play for you right now.
Is that so?
As soon as Todd pushes the button. <That's>
Just have to give me a half second here, because you didn't give me any setup time.
Sorry, I was
off we
up.
Go.
No, here we go.
This will go down in history for me. March 23rd. Oh, no, your historical is not the 23rd. It's the 24th.
What do you mean the 24th?
It's 1:30 already. It's morning.
And what a lovely morning.
Stars were shining bright.
Now the moment's on its way, and it's time to say goodnight.
So good morning, good morning. Sun, peace will soon shine through. Good morning to you.
You know, it's so fun to watch young people.
But
do
you
this
know what
show.
Is unusual about this? Because I've seen a bit of this.
Mm-hmm.
Most of the time, people are lip syncing. You guys are actually singing. You
and
know,
dancing, which is
and
very
is,
hard.
And,
to do.
And is the band pre-recorded, or how did you do the music?
Yeah, so it's a pre-recorded soundtrack.
But who pre-recorded it? You don't know.
I don't know.
No, because like even in the opening number we saw, the first number in the
Right.
pre-show, the music sounded great and you guys were singing really nicely against it. So, but you had to have edited it, was edited down. So obviously you had somebody with some, you got
Well,
a lot of skills. I'm seeing these sets.
right.
And the costume from the first number was spectacular. You know, that was a real like 1930s kind of outfit. It's
I
pretty
think
cool.
what we're wondering is if did live musicians go in and record that, or were they able to buy that and like
She's saying
play
they got the track, but
the track?
it is
Yeah.
live. I mean, it's not a.
What I'm saying though is, you know, was it a karaoke version, or did they have musicians go in and record it? Because if that was a karaoke version, I'm going out and I'm buying it immediately.
It's pretty dang good. I want to hear that myself.
Exactly. So we need to find that out, because that sounded great. Though we probably have your mom's recordings, you know, like
Well,
maybe.
we do, but they're
Because she
not going to
sang it
be, but
live.
not like that, because my mother would never have sung the entire song because it would have been done in her live Vegas act, and she would have not, you know, done the whole number. Rarely did she ever go through a whole song. You know, there was attention span issues here in Las Vegas. Got to get them back out to the slot machines.
Yeah. Well, there's something that I want to talk about for a really quick second, which was the Wax Museum. So you
Well,
were
before
in,
you do that, I actually
yeah.
brought something.
Oh, wait a minute. We have a on-air surprise apparently. What have we got
Well,
here?
I thought since she's such a big Singing in the Rain fan, she might appreciate seeing my mother's original script from Singing in the Rain. So,
Oh, wow. Do we have a close-up on you? We
well,
do. Good. Okay.
I mean, it's close enough. And
Yeah.
anyway, if you notice here, it's got her name here. But in this script, she had these bound. Obviously, didn't come leather on the set. But it has all of the notes and the changes. So like these are full of, and it also has still pictures from, like there's, you know, a still picture from. You know, but so they put pictures to go with the script. But here's something kind of cool. There's a piece of trivia in here that I'm going to share with you that's going to make you a very high on the trivia list, because even Robert Osborne at TCM did not know this. Here's a memo right here. I'll kind of walk up close to it. This came from Mr. Freed's office. He was the producer. And it's I'm going to walk up super close because
Yep.
maybe you could see it.
There you go.
Anyway, that's an MGM memo. And in that memo, and this is the only existing copy of this memo on Earth, it says this: the following name change has been made in the Singing in the Rain script, dated 4/11/1951. Kathy Sands has been changed to Kathy Selden. So the original name was Kathy Sands, not Kathy Selden. And nobody knew that. I mean, I was talking to Robert Osborne, who is gone now, but to me, he was probably one of the most knowledgeable trivia people on earth about everything,
Classic
and
movie, yeah.
especially, you know, Singing in the Rain and some of the big, important classic films. And I stumped him with that one, because not that I was born with that info. But anyway, that's her. Someday when you come visit us, you can see her script and the costumes and all of that. But there's a piece of trivia that nobody else will know, and you could win some money on that one.
That's true.
Okay.
So there was something called the Wax Museum, and it was you were in the third grade. Am I right about that?
Yes.
Okay. And so can you tell us what this was before we show it? You had to research a famous person and create a board and give a presentation, right?
Yes.
Okay. So let's talk about that.
Look at that freaking out. Where did you get that outfit?
Yes. Wow, that looks just like the dress.
That was why I brought it
Yeah.
up.
Look at you in third grade.
No, but I mean, someone
Hello
made
in
that.
that little
Who made that
dress.
for you?
Yeah, so we found the dress and then we sewed on like the stripe so it would
Wow.
look more like the dress.
I could tell you that is a
It
fantastic job.
really
And who did
is.
that for you? We, who is we?
My mom found it and then she, like our family, sewed it on. So,
I
yeah.
just want to congratulate you. I have to tell you, that is the best copy of that I've ever seen.
Okay, so
Thank
she had
you.
to research a famous person, which was Debbie, and
Yep.
create a board and give a presentation. In the evening, parents were there. There was a button on Natalie's chest, and when they touched the button, she came to life to talk about Debbie. So it was a wax museum. Do we have any footage on this, Ryan?
Well, we have this.
Oh, with the pictures, yes.
We
that's
do.
All right.
We do have footage.
We do have footage. Great, because I'd like
yes.
to see that. All right. Yoo-hoo! Ready?
It's called Todd should have it. It's called
I'm
the
ready.
Wax Museum.
I'm ready.
He's got his finger on the button, baby.
This
We're
time
ready.
I actually got some lead time into the thing, you know?
That's right. Here we go.
Singing and dancing. In 1952, I was cast as Kathy, singing in the rain. In 1969 to 1970, it was the Debbie Reynolds Show. I was in over 50 movies. I was born on April 1st, 1932 in El Paso, Texas, and died on December 28th, 2016, just last year, in Los Angeles, California, at the age of 84. I also died the day after my daughter. My real name is Mary Frances Reynolds. I had to change it because I went into acting. I didn't want to change it, so they let me keep my last name, but I still had to change my first name to Debbie. I was a Girl Scout when I was young. I was very good at impersonations. I did gymnastics. I was very cool when I was young, Chris. At the Miss Burbank contest, I was found by the Warner Brothers Studios and the MGM Studios. They had to flip a coin to see which one got to interview me first. There were some problems in my life, though. I was very unlucky in love. I married three people. Their names were Eddie Fisher, Harry Carl, and Richard Hamlet. I had two children. Their names were Carrie Fisher, which you might know as Princess Leia, and Todd Fisher. Carrie Fisher also got into acting, but she also got into drugs and we had fights. But later in life, we became best friends and eventually neighbors. People call me America's sweetheart. I was very devoted to my work. I also tried to open a museum with props and costumes from famous movies and shows.
Okay, you got me.
So cute. Good. By the way, that's...
Did you get you, Liz?
I noticed how much you knew off the cards. You had that almost memorized.
No, I was amazed by that. Really, you kept the cards there only for like a bullet point, right, Natalie?
Yeah. Yes.
So
Third grade.
I know. It made
right.
me cry.
Yeah, it was
because
really
it
well
was
done.
Kind of like having a little Debbie come to life, and we're still pretty sensitive about that. So, you know, it's that was a good one. Let me just get myself together.
Keep it together.
Okay. That's right. That's me.
It's the way of the world. It's the way of the world.
It's the way of the future.
It's the way of the future.
It's
the way of the future.
Like Howard Hughes. So in 2019, you performed in something called Overture of Rising Stars, and you were one of three youth acts to make the final show of 20. But before we go to that, I do have a question about the last thing that we just saw. What made you choose Debbie for your Wax Museum character to play?
Yeah, so I had basically grown up watching older shows like I Love Lucy and Gilligan's Island and Singing in the Rain. And I absolutely loved how watching Debbie Reynolds, you could see that she loved what she was doing. And she was such an inspiring person because I was doing theater at the time. So she just inspired me in like dancing, singing, and acting.
Me too.
Me three.
All of us were. No,
I was a Debbie Reynolds, Doris Day super fan when I was little. And you were too, I think, right?
Yes.
And let me just say this, you are, because you're still a little thing. I mean, you're going to be 14, and you know what's going to be great is that you have a wonderful voice. And your voice changes, you know, with every year you get older. Do you notice that can you sing high notes easier? Are you losing any of your bottom notes? Like, how is your voice changing from like 12 to 14, would you say?
Yeah, so when I was younger, I always struggled with hitting higher notes, but now I'm so much more comfortable with like a wider range.
I noticed that your higher notes are very clean, and you also have a nice belt in there. Do you consider yourself a belter, or do you consider yourself a soprano or mezzo-soprano? Where does your voice land?
Definitely a belter. You can ask my family, they'll all tell you that I'm a belter. So,
hey, yeah. Have you ever sung the belting part of all? I was not a belter, I'm a soprano. So when I did Les Mis, I had to learn how to belt because Fantine was it was more of a belting especially I Dreamed a Dream, which is, and I'm not a belter, and it was very, 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 very difficult for me to learn how to hit those notes. So have you stretched yourself yet with that belting voice by singing a song from Les Mis that maybe Cosette, On My Own is a great song.
Or Miss Saigon, too.
Have you tried that song yet?
Yeah, so I just started playing On My Own on the piano with singing. So I was just introduced to it recently.
Right, and it's a beautiful song. And when you get to that last note, it is, I'll bet you can just sail right through that. So, you know, having a belting voice is, I mean, that to me is just a dream come true. So congratulations that as you get older, your belt is getting stronger and your high notes are probably getting more clear. And it's just such a pleasure to hear you use your voice like that. So now I want to talk about the Overture of Rising Stars, which was in 2019. Can you tell me a little bit about that before we maybe play something from that?
Yeah, so it's a statewide talent competition. And this was the second year I did it. The first year I made it to the second round. And then when I did it recently, I made it to the last round where you do a show in the big theater and like a, it's at like an overture theater, meaning it's a lot of plays take place there and productions. Mm-hmm. So when I sang Born to Entertain from Ruthless, and I did tap dancing and singing for it. So.
Well, do we have anything to show from that, Ryan? I don't know.
You do.
Oh, let's do it then. You know I love the video. Let's do that.
Oh, jeez.
Look at Ryan. Look, Todd's like this. Oh, jeez. He didn't get any notice.
No, I
tried to give you a quick heads up on that.
Well, yeah. I got 5 seconds to lean forward.
Okay, so I'll fill those 5 seconds.
No, we're good. We're off and
running.
Okay,
here we go.
Some girls like to cook and sew. We know I cook, it's in a show. I was born to entertain. How you doing? Don't get too comfy in that suit. When I strut my stuff, you'll be on your feet. I was born to sing and dance.
Oh, you've been practicing.
To play Cosette in Les Mis, you have to make it happen. You have a fantastic belting voice, and if I do my math, you were like 11 going on 12 when you sang that, right?
Yes.
Unbelievable. We're all sitting here with our jaws open. You know, like
I also noticed
open.
your dancing was notched up a step there. You're definitely, you've been practicing, haven't you?
Yes.
Oh, I can't wait for you to play Cosette. And, you know, you can do Les Mis in schools now. And that theater that you are talking about that's there in Wisconsin.
Are you sure? Because there could be some...
No. They made it available to schools maybe 5 or 6 years ago.
So
maybe
it's not politically incorrect or anything?
It's not politically incorrect.
No, that's good.
You can go ahead and play, but you have got to play that role. You are Cosette through and through. I'm looking at it. Have you ever seen Les Mis, Natalie?
No, I have never seen it.
Okay, well, let me warn you that when you see it, you will do anything to play that part. First of all, it's the most amazing musical ever written. It's the greatest story of redemption ever told, and every character in it is fantastic.
Other than Singing in the Rain, of course.
Well, Singing in the Rain is a different kind of musical, but
I'm teasing.
Yeah, I really hope that you get a chance to see it. There is a movie version of it that's worth watching just to get the story.
I wouldn't watch that myself.
Well, where's she going to see it then?
There are probably some Broadway releases, possibly.
No.
You sure there's no DVDs of any Broadway shows?
I am positive.
Okay.
Yeah. They don't tape Broadway. They tape it once at some point, but you're not allowed to tape anything, show anything. They are probably...
No, but they can pay to do it.
Archives in New York City. That's what I think. But I'm not sure how it works to see that. Anyway, if you're in Wisconsin, and you must, watch the movie, and you will see Cosette, and you will know that is my part. I was born to play Cosette, and you are. So, Natalie, your birthday is tomorrow, right? That's how we sing happy birthday, because
Do you know why we do it that way?
No.
Okay, see, since you're such an insider, we're going to have to tell you. My sister used to joke about the fact that the song Happy Birthday was copywritten, and in the movies they don't use it very much because they have to pay to use it. So Carrie, in her infinite jokingness, decided that if she just sang everybody know what you were doing, but you wouldn't have to pay the royalties. So
there
you have it.
So that's a Carrie Fisher Happy Birthday.
So that is how we sing Happy Birthday in this family to all of our friends, and we just did it for you. So that's from Carrie to you.
Yes, indeed.
Thank you.
Now, since tomorrow is your hippo birthday, as we call it here, we have a surprise for you that your mom has. So let's bring on the mama. Let's bring her on. And what's your mom's name?
Her name is Sarah.
Sarah. It's time for your entrance. Hi, Sarah.
Hello.
First of all, congratulations.
You two look alike.
They do look alike. Congratulations, Sarah, on raising such an amazing child.
Thank you.
You must be proud. Kids don't get that way by themselves, so you are a fantastic parent.
Well, here's a bit of news, though. My mother had zero help from my grandmother and grandfather. My grandfather worked on the railroad. My grandmother could care less about showbiz. In fact, she would discourage it. In those days, the church was against entertainers. My mom got thrown out of the Nazarene church because she showed her legs, you know, in a dance number, and they said, you can't do that. So it was all against her, so she had no interest in it. So she had no support. So imagine the monster you have created.
Yeah. We always talk about she was very loud as a child. Very loud, and so we finally channeled it for good. So
yes,
now we use it for musicals.
Now, you know, my sister was so loud as a child that my mother had to implement rules like no singing at the table, because Carrie would sit down at the dining room table in the middle of, she would just bust into some loud song, whatever inspired her at the moment. And so we had to have special rules just because of her loudness.
Yeah,
oh. It does run like in our family. My mother is definitely, you know, you could tell. You've probably seen her in other things besides the films. You could see she's very charismatic, but also she's loud. So loud's probably a good thing.
Loud, it is. When you're a parent and you have a loud child, you know, if you channel it exactly right, which you have done, Sarah, then you end up with this wonderfully talented young lady.
I think trying to encourage her to work in a library would have been a bad idea.
Right, right.
Exactly.
Or dental hygienist school.
Yes, dental hygiene.
Yeah, which is when I was growing up and I knew I was going to move to Los Angeles to pursue an acting career, my father was a dentist. So I said, you know what, I'm going to go to dental hygienist school just so I have something to fall back on. And my father refused to let me do that.
And speaking of that,
so I'm glad
she had no help either. Zero help.
Right, right.
So imagine, you know, you guys got where you got that way with no help. And so having the support of somebody like you is a dream.
True. But you want to know something? And Sarah and Natalie, you probably will relate to this. But though I didn't have any help, I had a lot of inspiration, like Natalie does, from watching my favorites, Doris Day, Debbie Reynolds. You know, I had a lot of inspiration. Johnny Weissmuller was always at our house when I was little because my father was a prosthetic dentist. So he made, you know, the such beautiful teeth. And so movie stars would come to our house and stay at our house while they had their, you know, teeth worked on, because being on camera, they wanted to have, you know, teeth that looked real and perfect. And that was my dad. Johnny Weissmuller taught me how to swim. Burl Ives taught me folk music. And,
let's have a you know, one verse of Froggy.
Mr. Froggy went a courtin' and he did ridin'. Mr. Froggy went a courtin' and he did ride, sword and pistol by his side. So that was what
I love that song.
That's right.
One of my all-time favorite tunes.
So I was very inspired by the things around me. But I didn't know anybody in show business that could help me. I didn't have, like, help that way. But one thing I will say, and if for people out there that have kids, nobody told me, nobody said, oh, you can do this. But nobody told me I couldn't do it. So, you know, that's the main thing, is that, and when people ever say to you or your children, you can't do that, everybody wants to do that, what, you know, No, do not receive it. Have your own dreams. Believe in yourself. There's no doubt in my mind, Sarah, that you have instilled in your daughter to believe in herself. Am I right?
Absolutely. Anything's possible.
Anything is possible. And you know what? Let that be the theme of this show. Anything is possible. And thank you, Sarah, because that is so true. And it's when we don't believe in ourselves that we is our stumbling block. Because we must believe in ourselves to convince other people to believe in us. When you go in for a job interview, even if it's not in show business, any job interview, you know, all someone that's interviewing or auditioning you wants to see is that you believe in yourself, that you believe in your ability for the job you are there to audition for, whether it's a job, real world job, or an entertainment job.
Helps that you happen to have some talent, too.
Helps that you happen to have some talent. But you know what I've discovered? Is that you just have to have enough. And that's what's really true. You just have to have enough. Because if you're a really great person and people like being around you, if you have enough, you can always get better. But the people are going to hire the person that's the easiest to work with. Because no one wants to work with a diva, really, you know. It's not today anymore, for sure. It's nice, you know, people sometimes become divas after they become famous. I personally don't like that, because I like people to be accessible and to be what I believe them to be when I see them on screen.
Well, like people like my mother got classified, you know, as divas, but my mother did not act like a star. She was always very accessible to people, very real. That's why people loved her for 7 decades.
And still
But I mean, in her career, yeah. They came in droves.
People she worked with loved her.
They did.
Her professionalism.
And she never was trying to be above somebody or talking down to people. She connected with people. And most importantly, she connected with everybody that wanted to watch her. So every fan, she took a moment. She never turned away any fan. She never rejected them. And even when Carrie and I or other people would try to pull her away from her fans, she always kept that as a major priority and instructed Carrie and I that it was a major priority in our life. These are our extended family, the way she taught us, at even younger than you, that the fans were our extended family. So if you choose that line of work, that has to be your way of thinking. And my mother used to say to people all the time that she would see in the news that were, getting in fights with fans or press or whatever. And she said, you know, you really should consider another line of work, because this comes with the lunch. This is part of this is the job, because without them, you're nobody.
Right. Yeah, no, absolutely.
Try entertaining to an empty theater sometime and see how that works out.
So now, Sarah, the mama. You have something for Natalie for her birthday,
mm-hmm.
And I don't think
something
Natalie
early,
she
yep.
doesn't know what she's getting, right?
She does not know.
Yay!
She does
I look
not
good know. On camera surprise.
Here we go.
Here we go, Natalie.
Drum roll.
Oh, this is amazing. Oh, wow.
Thank you so much.
You're welcome. We have goosebumps.
Well, hold it on
up. Hold it up and let me see. You got a piece of the dance floor from the Debbie Reynolds Dance Studio. So let Todd talk to you about that, what you got in your hand there.
Well, so when we closed down the studio, I took all the floors up. Normally you'd say, why in the world would you tear up a bunch of dance floor?
And
the
answer, how many square feet?
Oh, thousands.
Okay,
it's a whole tractor trailer.
That's a job.
It was big, but keep in mind that floor came from the MGM studios. Fred Astaire, Eleanor Powell, Gene Kelly, my mother danced on those floors at MGM. They were moved from MGM to Debbie Reynolds Dance Studios in the early 70s or early 70s. And they stayed there for 40 something years. And then I brought them here, and then I had some extra pieces, and we made some of them for friends and family, and made a little plaque. And so that's a piece of history there. Michael Jackson danced on that floor, all the way to Fred Astaire. So it's for a dancer, it should be something you keep forever.
Yes, definitely.
Well, your mom, Sarah, wrote to Gene Kelly in middle school when she was doing a tap dance routine, and he wrote her back and sent her an autographed photo. Do you have that?
Yes, it's right here.
Look at that. Oh. See, back in the day when stars actually wrote people back and sent them autographed photos.
You know what they call that, right?
What do they call that?
Because entertainers back then had class. Today, not so much.
No. No, not at all. So that is.
So you could break the mold on that. You don't have to be that way just because everybody else acts that way. I don't think there's the role models. You see, the studio system was built to take somebody like yourself at a very young age and train them up in all these different disciplines, and including how they talked, how they walked, where they went, what they wore, how they did their hair. My mother, to the end, wouldn't go out without her full dress on and makeup on, and she just was. It was programmed into her.
Yes.
To always look her best, and that comes with the job. I mean, in my case, I'm not trying to pull that.
When I met Todd, Debbie said to me, "Could you please buy Todd some clothes?" And she wanted to give me money to buy you clothes because you were living on the ranch. And you always had on old Levi's and a t-shirt. And his mom wanted him to be dressed sometimes.
Well, she liked it when I go out. I would be her date sometimes. Yeah. Or she'd like it if I would dress up. But I just, since I was a little kid, I had a different experience. I didn't want to, I thought that was a hassle to do your hair and makeup and put on costumes and then have to take the makeup off. And then, as a 7-8-year-old boy, I was in the entertainment business and we were in TV shows and different things, and it's probably what turned me off is that at that age I just didn't want to have to shower or bathe every day at 7-8 years old. I mean, as a little kid, it's like a nightmare.
I'm glad that didn't carry over into your adult life. Just saying.
Well, I mean, it might have.
But anyway, Natalie, since you are now in middle school, we think it's only fitting if you also have a signed picture. And we're going to make sure that you get a signed picture of Debbie Reynolds.
Yes, we are.
So
Thank you so much. I'm so happy to know that, like, a signed picture that she signed this, and I'm going to have it. That's amazing.
We have a little stockpile of stuff that she saved and I saved. And so, we'll find something that kind of goes.
We'll find something really good for you. We'll find something perfect for you because after that's gone, then of course there's no more, correct? I mean, that's how it goes, unfortunately. So we're going to make sure that we find something really good for you, a signed picture of her or something signed by her that you would
really I don't mind giving away a signed Debbie thing from my inventory because it's going to somebody who I know will keep it for the rest of her life and so on.
Yes.
Sometimes when you sell something, you don't know what hands it's going into, or if somebody wins something or whatever the situation is. So on this show, when we give things away or whatever we do, I always say, if you aren't going to take care of this, please don't buy it. Please don't take it, because there isn't any more. I mean, it's not like you're going to get more of that. You could buy something on eBay, but How do you know how real that is? So, you know, that's a problem. There's a lot of bad stuff in the marketplace and all the collectible markets. So anyway, this way you know you have something for real.
Exactly. So in closing, I just want to say, Natalie, thank you so much for being our guest tonight, because it just means the world to us that you loved Debbie since you were a little girl and that she was your inspirer. And now let you be the one to carry the torch of inspiration to everybody everywhere to know, just like what your mom said, that anything is possible. And we just wish you the absolute best life and career, whatever it is you choose. We're very proud of you for the young lady that you are, and so happy that your mom raised you the way she did.
Thank you so much for having me on tonight. I've had so much fun.
I'm glad. Todd, you want to say anything to Sarah before we, not Sarah, Natalie, before we go? Oh, you can say something to Sarah too.
We've definitely addressed the mom. I would just say that keep doing what you're doing, because your passion is really paying off. I mean, I watched somewhat of a progression of your journey there in entertainment, and you're really making great strides and improving in so many ways. Your voice has improved, your dancing is improving, you know, and I'm looking forward to seeing, you know, what you do. And when we hope you're going to come visit us
in
Vegas.
Yeah, we're in Las Vegas, so if you ever come here, please let us know you're coming. We'd love to have you over. And you can see the museum that we have here for Debbie and Carrie's things and other. We have dance shoes from almost every famous dancer from the MGM studio days. We have all of their dance shoes, so it would be really fun for you to see all this. If your parents ever decide to come here, please let us know so we can have you over. We'd love to meet you in person. And in the world.
Yeah, of course.
Uh-huh. I'm sorry, go ahead.
Thank you so much. That would be so amazing.
And in the words of Journey, don't stop believing. Have a great one. We loved having you, Natalie. Thank you so much. And
thank you,
Ryan, for finding Natalie.
He's disappeared.
Ryan disappeared.
No, he's there. He just didn't say anything.
Oh, you're talking to me?
Yes, I said thank you for finding
Natalie. He never wants
Natalie.
To take credit for anything.
I know. All right, so we're going to let Natalie go.
Ryan, is your nickname Eeyore? Thanks for noticing.
That's right.
Or something.
Yeah. We're going to give some things away before we go. We want to thank Natalie for being here. And Ryan, you stay with us if you could. Let me just, you know, I haven't had a chance to look in the room and say hi to folks. Hello, Jennifer Klatt, Debbie Sanders Lewis. Look at, she said, you nailed it, Todd. They had total class. Yes, that's right. Hey, Francine Lobner, who had a birthday while we've been on this little hiatus. Hello, Lisa Falls, Catherine Bradley. Everyone's wishing Natalie a beautiful future, which is really good. Nikki Grandchamp says, my autograph picture of Debbie is in a frame on the wall. Hey, Patty Hale Hickland Ford. I love you, Patty. I'm so glad you're here. Beautiful girl. Deb Tyler, great. She said, great job. Debbie Bouchard, Linda Serber, Tracy Valine, Renee Simmons, so good to see. And a Papa Georgiou. Everyone's saying good luck. Hey, Patty Hughes is here. Diane Vasquez said she wrote the Mod Squad a letter when she was young and got an autographed picture back. You know what, Diane? I thought I was Julie from the Mod Squad when I was growing up. I was Julie. I dressed like her. I wore the bell bottoms with the painted flowers and the long blonde hair. So I totally get that. Totally. Hey, Joe Hughes, the fluting bit, what does that mean? The fluting bit made me cry. A good cry. I'm not sure if that's a typo, but let me tell you something. Anytime you have a good cry, that's okay by me. I love it. A good cry is the best thing. Debbie used to have good cries. Every time Todd and I, when we first started dating, do you remember this?
Sure.
We would go to Debbie's house, and we would sit and hold hands, you know, at the dinner table, and she would look at us and start to cry. We'd be like, why are you crying? And she'd say, oh, I just am so happy to see it. She loved watching Love. So she was a sentimental crier. I don't think I ever saw your mom cry over anything but Something Beautiful.
That's true.
I never saw her cry over anything else.
When I came to her to tell her that Carrie had passed.
Oh, I wasn't in the room for that.
Yeah, I was, obviously.
Yeah, I know. What was her
She didn't
reaction?
Cry.
She didn't cry.
No, I was a wreck, and she didn't cry.
Really?
Yeah.
Stoic?
not stoic, but
what was it?
Solemn, but you know, like it was just, you know, she always knew everything. So she had long prepared, I guess. But she was like, well, I wish we could have had her for more time and blah, blah, blah. And we knew it was coming someday. I mean, we had her for a long time. Things that we had always said and thought but never spoke, which is that, you know, at any moment, the other shoe could drop with Carrie.
Right.
You know, there were many times where, you know, where she never thought it. But early on, she used to, shall we say, be more afraid when something would happen.
Yeah.
Or she would do something wrong or overreact or how you put it, you know, abuse drugs, whatever.
Yeah.
And that would cause her sometimes to be afraid. But later in life, she got kind of probably just too comfy with it all, you know.
Are you talking about your mom?
My sister.
Oh, your sister.
And that's
yeah.
But my mother was saying, look, you know, any minute now, you know. And so at the end, my mom was like, look, we had her for 60 years. I mean, we thought we'd have lost her at 30.
I think you're very right about that. I mean, I know you are, because I remember your mother telling me several times in quiet moments of discussion we would have about life and things, and she would say that she had been waiting for that phone call.
Yeah, sure.
For decades. And so, you know,
the truth is we had had the phone call many times, but she always pulled through.
Right.
So even when I got that call, when we were up at the winery up in Paso Robles, mm-hmm. you know, I mean, I didn't believe that was it. I mean, you know, because we'd been through, she always, you know, faked it all out. She somehow pulled through, always.
And I think I told you, I knew that that was it. I knew that was it from the minute that phone call came through, even though days went, how many days? Three or four days. She was in the hospital. I knew that it was it because I was feeling incredible peace, and it wasn't my peace. So I knew if it wasn't my piece, then whose piece was it? And it
well,
was Carrie's.
And there's something to be said for that. I mean, she was a tortured soul in certain respects.
Yeah.
I mean, in some respects, she was like happy-go-lucky. And then because of the bipolar disorder, there were times where, you know, she was truly, you know, deeply unhappy. And I didn't understand it. You know, she used to say, it was the way I was brought up. You're always trying, when you're going into therapy, you know, when for 40 years, you're always trying to find a reason why things are.
Mm-hmm.
So she used to say, you know, it was my upbringing. I'm like, yeah, I don't think so. You know, I was there. And it wasn't like what you think it is. Well, it was my parent. Okay, you got screwed over by Eddie, but he wasn't around either. So I don't know how that can drag you down. I mean, we're always trying to find a reason because they didn't know about bipolar disorder.
Right.
But later on in life, you know, not being able to, you know, control your moods. I have great compassion for those people.
Oh, yes.
It is a you know, to be out of control of yourself,
mm-hmm.
out of control of the way you respond and react to things, and a moment to moment, you don't know what it's going to be. You could wake up in the morning and you could, Carrie used to name her moods, Rollicking Roy and Sediment Pam. You wake up in the morning, you could be Rollicking Roy and you want to go out and, you know, go shopping, you know.
Conquer the world.
Yeah. And nothing can stop you. And then on the other spectrum, you come back and, you know, you're so depressed. And then that's when she would want to take drugs to level those moods out.
Yeah.
So it's a complicated issue. It's certainly not something, boy, I hope nobody's judging anybody that has that, because it is not, if you don't walk in those shoes, baby.
That's you will, right. You will never understand.
You're not going to get it. And all you can do, I said this on a public service piece I did where I just said, all you can do is love them through it, you know, as much as you, that's all you can do is give that,
mm-hmm.
because you can't control the moods, and the doctors can't either. The drugs they give them, in mild cases, sure, but in Carrie's case, and millions of people,
there's
varying degrees of this. Carrie had a pretty extreme case. When she was young, we didn't know what was going on at all, but by later on, we did, and the drugs, as far as I'm concerned, the drugs did little for decades.
Right.
Now, all this started because you were talking about...
What was I talking about?
Debbie's happiness or something, right?
Yeah, well, Debbie was, yes, she, yeah, for sure. I just want to take a moment because Frank Ferruccio is in the room, and we have not been able to... We've been so busy, as we've been... there's an addition being built on the house for the archives, and so...
And we want Frank to come help us with that.
And so, Frank, if you're still here, I miss you so much. I miss hearing your voice. I miss seeing your face on FaceTime. We have just been slamming and jamming, and... I'm so happy you're here. I know you're not, I just saw that you were poking your head in and not staying long, so let me take this opportunity to just say to you, we love you and miss you, and wait till you see this place, so make sure you get better soon, because we want that to be sooner than later. And so we are going to give away things in a few minutes, and I just wanted to acknowledge a few more people and see what everybody's saying on here. People are so sweet. Diana Goach says, I understand that, Todd. We have numerous mental and learning disabilities in my family, and I can understand the mood swings. Frank says, I am really ill. I love and miss you both. Okay, Frank, gonna call you tomorrow. I've got to hear about this. I don't want you to be ill, but I know that that's the way it is, whether I want it or not. So I'll catch up with you tomorrow on that for sure. Diana Goach, I just want to touch on what you said. Yes, that is very difficult. I remember when we were in the Telluride Film Festival with Bright Lights, and Carrie was also there with us. And we went to some kind of party there that someone was having for all the stars of the movies and things like that that were screening at the Telluride Film Festival. And there was a young actor who came up to us. He came up to us, and he was starring in a movie. I don't remember his name, and I wouldn't say it anyway because it's a personal story. But he came up to us and introduced himself to Todd. And what he was sharing with Todd was how much Bright Lights meant to him, because seeing Carrie in her natural habitat and talking so frankly and openly about her mental illnesses, which is what she was so loved for in addition to her acting career, because she took the stigma out of mental illness of any kind. And so people really appreciated that, as we all do. But this young actor came up and introduced himself. I knew who he was because I had seen the movie, and Todd as well. And he's brilliant, and he's been in many movies. But he came up to talk to Todd because his sister had a very severe case of bipolar disorder. And he felt like he could actually talk to somebody. It was a relief because she had it so bad and did not stay on her medications, and the parents were going down. And he just felt so relieved about being able to talk to somebody that would understand. And you had quite a long conversation with him, and the pain in his face, you know. So it's good because,
well, keeping in mind that he was half my age or less, so he clearly, I've been where he was.
Yes.
at his age. Mm-hmm. Looking at it, and here I am all those years later. So I learned a few things. I mean, there's nothing you can truly learn other than how to deal with it on your personal level, meaning the way I would deal with it. So I shared with him how I deal with it. So hopefully that helped him. But lots of people out there with those family members suffering those kinds of things, and that suffering can't help but to permeate throughout the entire family, because anybody with any empathy at all,
yeah,
is going to feel for those family members, and then you're like, what can I do? So I tell you, if I wasn't a person of faith, I don't think I would. I told him this too. I said, I don't know if I could have handled it the way I handled it, because the idea that there's a higher power that is going to oversee this with you alone, not so good. My mother and I are a formidable force.
Yes.
Ask some of the people we went up against. Ask her third husband. I mean, we're formidable. But it's child's play when you're coming up against this type of stuff. You need God to intervene and to really to take the burden off of you. If it's all on you, that's a heavy burden.
Well, and also for the strength, you know, because mm-hmm. that's also a great requirement, both the person suffering and the people in the family.
I love the idea that we don't walk alone.
Me too. I think that was probably the thing that made me gravitate towards my Christianity, was that, you know, I don't walk alone. And you know, no matter how many times in my life I've walked away and tried to do stuff on my own and made a good mess out of my life,
well,
there was always God waiting for me with open arms to put it all back together. And, you know, so,
you know, some of the best loners are actually people that have embraced that they're not alone in the God sense.
Right.
Because when you walk alone, literally the loner can walk with God and have peace.
Right.
And they don't always have to be just a loner.
It's not about the building, baby. It's about the relationship, we always say. So listen, Diane, thank you for sharing that, Diane Goetsch. And, very well. But let's all be very loving towards each other and kind towards each other and understanding toward each other, because most people are struggling with something. And we don't know what that is. So, be kind always and be in love. All right.
Compassion.
Walk in love and have compassion. That is true. Now, we are going to give things away.
And speaking of compassion, Kat is feeling so compassionate.
You make fun of me for wanting to give things away.
It comes from compassion.
Yes.
She feels so compassionate that she has to share her good fortune with all of you.
Exactly. We have Liz Cochran in the house.
Put up your hand.
Wave your hand back there. Say
there
hi.
You are. No, there's... she's, look, the light's on her face and everything. We saw her.
Oh, Liz, look at that hair growing out. It's not Chia Pet anymore. It's hair. It's, really.
Well, I walked in and I said, I want whatever this color is.
in that patch right there? Let me tell you, I think you look great. This is like, how many people would pay good money for this haircut? And it's not a haircut. It's just your hair growing in, right?
Yeah. We shaved it. We did shave.
Exactly. And behind you is Andrea, who's visiting from Massachusetts.
Put up your
hand.
Hello,
Andrea. There you go. She's saying hi. And you see Andrea shaves her head. And so, it's like, so Andrea, do you ever let it grow back? Or do you get it to an inch and go, oh, I like that? Or do you just always shave it? Is this your first time you shaved your head?
Yeah.
And how?
It's so freeing.
It's freeing. Well, you look good, too. You know, it's amazing. If people go, oh, I didn't know I had such a nice shape to my head. But, and there's a lot of people out there that have to shave their heads, not because they want to, but because they have to. And every time I see a woman with her head shaved, I think, wow, you look really beautiful. It's really true. So you guys are brave, but I'm loving what's growing in here. Oh, I don't want to make an announcement that Liz's mother is in remission, which is a miracle. I didn't even have a chance to talk to you about this yet. I saw it on Facebook. I mean, they just gave her 6 to 9 months more to live. And, let me tell you something. When someone gives you time like that, I don't like it when doctors do that, because the subconscious mind, it's coming from an authority figure. So someone says you have... 6 to 9 months to live, or 3 months to live, or 1 month to live, well, the subconscious mind starts ticking back because it loves to keep time. And so, it's like you just don't receive that. I'm giving her a lifetime. That's it. She's, I'm not going to put any restrictions on time. And I don't want anybody here to have to receive that when you're told that you have this much time to live.
Well, you don't have to ask.
What? You don't have to ask. But people don't. Doctors just come out.
No. No.
What do you mean?
Traditionally, people ask. They want to know. That, like, the number one question, I've talked to a number of doctors about
this.
Really? Number one question is, how much time? How long does this stay with me, or whatever the deal is? But always about time. Doctors are asked that constantly. Some doctors are smart and will say, there's no way to know.
That's the good answer.
There's no way to know for sure, especially when you're dealing with something like cancer. There is a lot of variables, and there are a number of factors.
And let's not forget miracles.
That's
which
what
I
was. That's the
of.
Factor I was yes. referring to.
Right, right.
This was a case of us saying we put it in God's hands, and look what happens.
Right, they put it in God's hands, and that's a good place to do it.
This is a case of us putting it in God's hands, and look what happens. And let me tell you, I have seen more miracles in my lifetime, in the walks of life that I've had, in very hard places with people that had zero hope, and then they were given a chance to believe in a miracle, and they did. And hey, you know what? I believe in them, and I am so thrilled for you, Liz, about your mom, because I know that this has been a very hard and torturous time. Maybe it's because you shaved your head in solidarity. You never know. You just don't know. God might have smiled down just on that, but I'm happy for your mom, and I'm happy for you. So that's really good. I love a good, we call these praise reports, don't we?
Mm-hmm.
So when we say, I have a praise report, it means because you believed, and so it is, you know. So there's our praise report for the day. Okay, let's give stuff away. You have been assigned a number tonight. We're going to do the wheel. You've been assigned a number the minute you walked in the room. We're going to spin the wheel. When the wheel lands on a number, Liz will tell me who the wiener is. Wieners. We have our wieners here. So here we go. We're going to spin the wheel. Liz, are you going to spin it?
Let me get the...
Since you're looking so darn cute.
Give me 1 second. I'll put the camera
okay,
on that.
Okay, so we have the gifts. You want to hand me that bundle?
Yes.
And then you can spin that wheel and tell me who the wieners are. Here we go. Wiener number one, take a spin. He's going to put his camera on.
All right,
the wheel.
We're ready.
Okay, there it is. There we go.
I think maybe that was a little
Next
too energetic.
Next time we'll do a shorter spin. Can you see the number?
It's four.
Four, number four, who dat?
Patty Hughes.
Hello, Patty Hughes. You're the wiener tonight. Here we go. You have won.
I'm going to turn this light on just so we have a little hit on that.
Rich lip gloss. And let me tell you why this is so good. This is in the new packaging. It's so pretty. It looks like a jewel. So you have won rich lip gloss, which I know you wear, and you wear it so well. So there you go, Patty Hughes. This was donated by Cat Cosmetics, and I want to congratulate you on being a wiener. So there you go. It's going to be sent to you. I do have your address, so you don't have to claim it because I just saw that you are in the room. So we will just get that out to you. Did you write Patty Hughes down? You rock. Okay, number two, give it a little spin. Well, not little, but... Well, you know what? It's on point tonight. We're not having any problems with it. So you're going to have to tell me who the number is. 58, 58, donated by, and who is 58?
Linda Factor.
Linda Factor, you are the wiener of a prize donated by Barb Kevern. Barb Kevern is a big believer in what she is about to give you because she has used it and it has helped her enormously in both her sleep and anxiety. And it is a CD of Spiritually Reconnecting Through Prayer Hypnosis Program. There it is. See, it's got my little face on it. This is an amazing little tool for you, Linda Factor. If you don't have a CD player, because you're going to listen to this before you go to bed, never in the car or operating heavy machinery, but you will. You also, if you want it on a flash drive, you may have it that way. Please go ahead and claim your prize at info@catcosmetics.com and tell me if you would like to, and I'm going to need your address and email address, if you would like a download, or would you like the CD, or would you like it on a flash drive? So info@catcosmetics.com, Linda Factor. Congratulations, Barb Kevern. Thank you for donating that. Okay, number three, spin that wheel. Here we go. Spin that wheel. Mm-hmm. Hey, Kathy Gans, Barbara Rue. 46, there you go. 40. Deb Root White. Deb Root White, go ahead and invite me at info@catcosmetics.com. Claim your prize. Let me know your email address. Or address, because, well, let me see what you won there. Okay, here we go. This is donated by Cat Cosmetics, so I know it's something good. Here we go. Ah, you have won my favorite lipstick in the entire world. I know it's not very close, but let me put it up against my black shirt so you can see
it. I can go close.
You can?
I can go close.
Todd is going close. The closer you get, the better you look. All right, so
put it up against your shirt there.
Okay, there it is. This is the most perfect tube of lipstick, and the lipstick I wear almost all the time. This and Rich Lip Gloss are my go-tos. Maiden Lane is the name of this lipstick, and you are going to love it. It is shade that looks good on everybody, every skin type, every color type. It's absolutely amazing. And so, Deb Root White, I need to hear from you at info@catcosmetics.com, and we'll send that out to you right away. And thank you. Let's go on to the next wiener. Spin that wheel. All right. And the winner is?
Number 7.
Did we claim 7 already?
No. Nope.
Okay.
It is Paula Andrea Mickle.
Paula Mickle? Hello, Paula. I saw your post that your mom's birthday was yesterday, and so you were celebrating your mom's heavenly birthday. And so I want to say happy birthday to your mom in heaven, too. And I want you to know that this has been lovingly donated to you by Barbara Hammond. It is a $25 gift certificate to catcosmetics.com. Paula, go ahead and claim your prize at info@catcosmetics.com. And make sure I have your email address, and we will get that link out to you. Thank you so much. And remember, we're always thinking about your mom, and I know that this is probably a hard first for you to have since she graduated to heaven. So we're thinking about you, Paula. Thank you so much, Barbara Hammond. I appreciate it. Thank you. Next wiener. Okay. And the number is
19.
Who dat?
That is Denise Falconer Smith.
Oh, Denise Falconer Smith. Hello, Denise. How are you? You have one, and I believe this is from me, catcosmetics.com. It's I'm just synonymous with this company because, of course, it's my company. You have won a brand new color. Todd, can we have a close up on this? And this is called Squeeze, and it's one of our newer liquid lips. So it's a lipstick in, wow, that is really close, a lipstick in a liquid form. It does not dry to matte. It is a beautiful shine. It is gorgeous. It's called Squeeze. It looks good on everybody. And sometimes people want just a little more of a tint, and there you have it. So congratulations. Please write me at info@catcosmetics.com so that we can get that to you, claim your prize there, and give us your address so we can send it out to you. Okay, we're going on to the next wiener. All righty. Hello, Shannon Johnston. Good to see you here. Who's the number?
37.
37 it is. 37, whose name is on that?
Sherry
King, you have really been lucky lately. You need to go out and buy a lottery ticket. You got to be in it to win it, baby. I don't know what state you're in, but get that lottery ticket because you've been on a winning streak. This is donated by, I'm going to guess. Oh, this is donated by Barbara Hammond. Thank you, Barbara, so much. Barbara also donated the Spiritually Reconnecting Through Prayer CD. Again, if you want it in a download, you can have it. If you want it in the CD, you can have it. And if you want it in a flash drive, you can have it. So you just write us at info@catcosmetics.com, Sherry King, and let us know how you want it. You don't get that question every day. Write me and let me know how you want it. That is great. Congratulations. Thank you, Barbara Hammond. Thank you. Thank you as always. We are on our last prize. I don't think so. What's this? Oh, 7 prizes. Okay. So it's our last prize. We are our last. Usually we have 8, but tonight you cannot imagine the hot scramble we were in before the show. It was a busy day, but we're really happy. This is donated by Cat Cosmetics. So let's go ahead and say, we're going to go ahead and say what it is in a moment. We're going to get the wiener first. Let me know what number you see there, Liz.
I'm 18.
18 it is. Who's the wiener?
Elizabeth Gandy.
It's so funny. Last night, Carol Grundy won. And I get Carol Grundy and Elizabeth Gandy mixed up because the names are kind of similar. Elizabeth, you are a wiener, and you have won a $25 gift certificate to catcosmetics.com. Go ahead and write me at info@catcosmetics.com. Claim your prize, and we will send this to you in a link, so make sure you leave me your email address, okay? All right, so that is it. We have given our show, and I really want to thank Ryan for finding Natalie for us. And, you know, I want to congratulate her on all of her beautiful work in this, at the ripe old age of 14 tomorrow. And Ryan, I just love you so much. You're such a beautiful friend, and I'm so proud to have you as one of my closest friends. Thank you very much. I also want to thank everybody for coming tonight. I know it's Saturday night. You might have had something better to do, but here you are. You spent it with us. I want to thank Elizabeth Cochran, Liz for coming. I call her Lizard because we go back a long way. Lizard from Jersey for coming and after a long day of work, she comes over here to help, which is awesome. I also want to say that I'm excited that Andrea has come here, and so we're having a good time. Andrea and I are going to do some great things together. And Todd Fisher, I need you to come up here and say goodnight to everybody. And then I have to lock Teddy's cage up. In fact, I don't know if you might want to put the chicken cams up to say goodnight so everybody can say goodnight to each other. They are out. Look at those birds, out like a light. Einstein, is he like, look, the turkey, is his head is so far over. We have two roosters sleeping in the house as we speak, and they're hilarious when they sleep. One falls off the perch a couple of times because he's so tranced out.
See, I zoomed out the camera super wide so they could see the set from the side. No one ever sees the set.
And oh, that's true. Let me see what that looks like. I'm going to put on my seeing eye dogs. I'm looking there. I'm looking at the monitor. That is cool to see the set from that side, isn't it? It is so cool. It's okay, so we've got, let's see, we're going to just leave that on for a few minutes. Todd, say goodnight to everybody because they want to hear from you always. Hey, Barry Mulan.
Good night.
Good night, my love. Pleasant dreams will always be, right?
Yes, indeed.
Okay, we love you. You just have to know that.
When you're asleep.
When you're asleep. We're coming up on the anniversary of the show soon, aren't we? 2 years, is it?
I lost count.
2 years in March of our show. And you know what's funny?
I lost count.
The funny thing is that we said, I don't know how funny this is, but we used to say, people would say, when COVID is over, you're still going to do the show, right? Well, yes, we did say we were going to still do the show, but it's still not over, right? What is up with that? But I have a funny feeling. Because we're on this
Groundhog Day.
Groundhog Day, exactly. But you know what? 98% of the COVIDs out there right now is Omicron. Everybody I know has had it, including us. We've had it.
Not me.
Not you. Not you. Andrea and Liz have, but all my friends.
But if you've had the other
all
version,
over the place
you had the
I
first
have
one.
It.
You had the A. You haven't had anything.
You haven't had any? Neither one of you. Oh, we had the first round, which was like, wow. But the Omicron for both
the
of
Omicron
us,
is
it's like
really,
a cold
it's,
for us.
It
was
very minor. But certainly, if you have other conditions, then it's nothing to mess with. But certainly a minor issue.
Right.
A kicked
we
my
lucky.
Ass.
Hmm?
A was rugged. A is difficult.
B was, we didn't get, thank God. And C, which is what we're on now.
There are actually many variations.
I mean,
but COVID's been around for decades.
That's what's out there.
COVID viruses have been around for decades. So if you look it up, there's a long, that's how we're getting into all these, we're at O.
You know what? At first I thought they called it COVID-19 because it was 2019 when it started, right?
Well,
I didn't know that we've had several years of COVID strains.
Well, as you know, they have. There's been lots and lots of COVID strains.
Yeah.
This one, though, was genetically modified.
Yeah.
So it has a little nuance to it, meaning the A type. Now, interestingly enough, the A type is now mutated into several other types, and now you have Omicron. So hopefully this thing's winding itself down.
And I believe it is. And here I have a theory about why it was so virulent. And it could be true or not true. But when I got it, when I had it, I thought I just had a cold. I had a sore throat.
Actually, you said
my nose was running.
No, what you said in type A? Are we talking about?
No.
Omicron.
When I got Omicron, I thought I just had a cold because it was mild. But I had a sore throat and I had a runny nose and I sneezed. Okay, I was tired, but not like when we had COVID-19 the first time. So, you know, I thought I just had a cold, and I think most people that get it. Because everyone out there is 98% of the people, of all COVID that's out there now, is Omicron. I think most people have had it. They say it's running out of people to infect. But you just think you have a cold, so you go out in the world and you're infecting people and you don't know it. Because you
highly
think you
contagious.
Just had a cold. It's highly contagious.
More contagious.
But I think
more contagious than any cold I'm aware of.
But people that went out there not knowing they had Omicron
right.
infected a lot of other people, and then those people infected people, and a lot of people didn't know they had Omicron.
Well, look, when before we were even talking about Omicron, it
yeah.
was already here.
We're calling it the Cron.
The Cron.
When you have it,
but,
it's
but
the
you
Cron.
Know what I mean? It's like
yeah.
when they were blaming everything on South Africa, it was already here. I mean, I'm convinced that you had it. You were one of the early adopters of the
Oh,
Omicron.
Yeah. Well, because so. When I went on that cruise and I got really sick, and that was just...
Just saying, it's been around.
That was 2 months before COVID-19 was announced, and I went on a cruise, and I got super sick after the second day, and I was sent to my room, you know, for bad behavior, and just stayed there till we came back to port.
A lot
was
of
like,
fun there.
I spent all this money to come on this cruise, and I have to stay in my room. And then 6 weeks later, COVID broke. So I don't know if that's what it was, but I will tell you that, you know, I'm just really happy we seem to be on the downswing of this. Here is the thing. In the UK, Omicron swept through like crazy. And now it's like cruising downtime. And
well, as you know
really, we follow the UK. Which
but the UK is just a giant cruise ship. I mean, it's a small island.
Yeah.
And when you live in a smaller country
yeah.
and people all intermix, especially London, you know, you're gonna circulate. It's like the big cities are obviously.
Well, New York City.
Yeah. But if you live out in Nebraska or Montana, you know.
Like Shannon Johnston does. She lives in Montana. And so, you see, I know where everybody lives. Isn't that funny? After 2 years,
and
I know,
you know all
your
their names,
where you live. I know your social security numbers.
Right, passwords, everything.
Anyway, I love you guys. We do love you. Thank you for coming to visit with us tonight on this Saturday night. And don't stop believing. And remember, anything is possible. It is true. Have a great weekend, everybody. A great weekend. I think it's Monday's a holiday, right?
Yeah.
It's MLK Day. Martin Luther King Day. All right, guys, good night and be safe.